We live in a dangerous world today, and at the heart of it all is religion.
When you accept Christ as a savior, it changes your heart, changes your life.
These days, it's not just economics or politics which drive world events, but faith. And believers are as convinced as ever.
We believe every word of the Bible to be divinely ordained, God giving it to Moses, and being written down for future
generations. God said it. That settles it. I believe it.
They believe the Bible is the word of God, that faith can justify anything. But is it really God's word? It's time we knew for sure. Who wrote the Bible? My name's Robert Beckford. I'm an academic theologian. That means I study religion for a living. In the last few months, I've been on a quest to discover the origins of the Bible, to find out who the biblical authors were and what they were trying to achieve. It's been an amazing journey. It's taken me to places that I've never been before. I've learned who wrote the Bible and then who rewrote it afterwards. It's made me doubt some of my basic Christian beliefs. And in order to understand this, you've got to know where I'm coming from. I began this journey in another seat of learning. I went home to talk to my mother. This is where I grew up. Every week I came here with my mum to take part in traditional worship. The Bible was an important part of my childhood.
Our lesson for today, I'm going to show you something there. Now I want to see the hands of those who think they know what this is.
I'm in the Wesleyan Holiness Church in Handsworth, and my mother's teaching Sunday school, the story of Jonah. And this is so important to me because this is where I learnt about the Bible and learnt to read it as the Word of God.
And I want you to go there and tell those people to stop being so bad.
The Bible shaped what you said, what you thought, what you did. Now, I'm grateful for that because if I didn't have that, I wouldn't have a doctorate in theology. I'd probably have a doctorate in drug dealing or baby fathering. So although it was pretty rigid, it kept me in check.
As I grew older, I tried to hold on to that simple faith, but my studies taught me that it wasn't going to be that simple. The stories about creation and the Garden of Eden were more symbolic than literal. And if the Bible is less literal, what is there to hold on to? Is it really the Word of God? So I've lived a kind of schizophrenic existence, and I now think it's time to plant myself in one camp or the other, or find a way of bringing the two together. I need to know who wrote the Bible. And the best place to start is where it all began.
In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth, and the earth was without form and void. And God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And the evening and the morning were the first day.
According to both Jewish and Christian traditions, the first five books of the Bible, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy, were all written by the prophet Moses in the desert of Sinai.
We're going into the desert in the footsteps of Moses because that's where the Bible begins.
Now Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. And he led the flock to the backside of the desert, and came to the mountain of God, even to Horeb. And the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. And he looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed.
Out here in the silence and the emptiness, a story like that is easy to believe.
Whenever you hear the desert mentioned in the Bible, it means that something special, something significant has taken place. So just being out here gives me a sense of some kind of importance, some kind of a sense of revelation. It's where people have silence, and as a consequence of that, they hear the voice of God.
So maybe we should take the story of Moses literally.
The Christian within me wants to believe that Moses wrote the Bible and that from being in this kind of environment, he heard the voice of God and was able to write things down. But the historian within me questions that and wonders whether it's actually possible for somebody to write down that amount of literature on such a vast range of subjects in this place.
If Moses didn't write the first five books of the Bible, then it's a big lie. It would mean that religious people have been taught to believe something that's completely false. Yet historical truth is one of the fundamental aspects of the Bible. Large parts of it concern history. Archaeology is one of the ways in which you test history. And Jerusalem is full of it. Here, soon after the Second World War, archaeologists began to uncover what is now known as the City of David. Today, it's frontier territory on the border between Arab and Jewish Jerusalem. Right on top of the ancient site is a new Jewish settlement. At first glance, it looks just like a pile of rubble. But if the Bible history is true, these walls were built by King David and Solomon to defend the capital of their great kingdom, which stretched from Iraq to the Mediterranean.
So the wall here would be protecting the palace behind.
Palace behind, right. People live and build the buildings under the palace. As we see here, it's rooms the people live. And the area, it's around David time.
Some Israelis feel they need this science to prove the Bible is a historical record and that this land is their land.
How important is it for Jews in Israel to be able to show that the walls of David existed and David existed?
The beginning is start here. When we arrive here, we start to build our country, and Jerusalem was the most important. So this is the basis, the religious basis that we stand on it.
So this is where it all begins, in these stones?
Yes. It's not only stones. I mean, we can see only stones, but it's the basis of our religion and basis of our land, our country.
This was Royal David's city, like the one I had sung about at home. And at first, the archaeology seems to confirm the Bible stories. But not all archaeologists are so convinced that you can dig up Old Testament tales in a modern excavation. One of the leading experts has dug for years at the ancient site of Megiddo. He has big problems with the idea that the Bible is a history book for the land of Israel.
When people came here to Megiddo and other places in the Holy Land, the idea was to look for evidence for the biblical stories, to look for a decoration, to look for a manifestation. That is to say, you have the biblical story, they all took the biblical stories as the ultimate truth, and they only wanted to decorate this truth with the, you know, beautiful finds, with the monuments, and there was no thinking about, you know, the power of archaeology to verify the real events that took place, you know, in the second or in the first millennia.
So biblical archaeology rubber-stamped Old Testament history.
Exactly.
The biblical archaeologists thought they had found evidence for the magnificent kingdom of David and Solomon, which the Bible says held sway in the 10th century BC. If you believe the Book of Kings, this was when much of the Old Testament was written down. But Israel Finkelstein says the dates simply don't match.
We are standing now in what's called the Solomonic, quote-unquote, gate of Megiddo. So this monument, was described as Solomon from the days of Solomon and a manifestation of the grandeur and the glamour of the United Monarchy. However, the gate probably dates to the 8th century BC, and Solomon is supposed to be in the 10th century. So you have 2 centuries between Solomon as an historical figure, and there was a Solomon, and the gate, which is much later.
So biblical archaeology got the dating of the Solomonic Gate completely wrong.
Solomonic Gate and many other monuments, because the whole dating, the whole system of dating of the strata, archaeological strata, and the monuments related to the period of the United Monarchy a little bit before and a little bit later was, in my opinion at least, completely wrong.
This is a bombshell. Archaeology now tells a completely new story of Jewish origins. No big kingdom, as the Bible tells us, no exodus from Egypt either, just scattered small settlements in the hills. In the north, these develop into a kingdom called Israel. In the south, there's another called Judah. Its capital is Jerusalem, but it's not at all as the Bible tells us.
First of all, you look at Jerusalem, but what you see is not a great city, a capital of a great empire. You see a small village, very limited in number of people. There's almost nothing there, few pieces of sherds here and there, and not much more than that. And then also, even more important than that, in order to have a text, so powerful and so elaborate and so advanced, you need to see evidence of inscriptions. Archaeology does not provide this evidence. I mean, literacy comes mainly in inscriptions and writing and scribal activity. All this comes much, much later, centuries after the days of David and Solomon.
More bombshells. We lose not just King David and the Exodus, but all the Genesis stories too. Abraham's promise, Isaac and Jacob, all of them now have a question mark beside them. It's one thing to consider stories about Adam and Eve and Noah as mythical, because they are those kind of stories. But if Finkelstein is right, as I think he is, then it's much more serious. I decided to resolve the matter by taking a closer look at the book, the text itself. Was it what it claimed to be, a unique testament, the word of God, or was it just another piece of literature?
The new 7-seat Verso. How Verso are you?
Can't blame them.
Nah.
Reckon if it ain't the amber nectar, don't even bother.
That'll be the 735 from Dubbo.
Yeah.
See Britain's best loved comedian in a dramatic new light.
Distinguished guests, and just in case, Your Majesty.
Exclusive footage, newly uncovered notebooks and audio tapes.
This doctor has a great reputation. They say that if you're on death's door, he'll pull you through.
The Unseen best Eric Morecambe, Monday at 9 on 4.
Modern archaeology has exploded the idea that the Old Testament is an accurate account of ancient history. But it tells us nothing about who actually wrote the Bible. For that, you need to go back to the text. When you look at it more closely, it's a bit of a muddle. Take the creation story in Genesis 1. God creates the heavens and the earth, the animals and the fish, and then finally gets round to creating humankind. So God made man in his own image, in the image of God, he created him, male and female, created he them. Then in Genesis chapter 2, He does the same thing all over again, but this time he begins with creating Adam and then finally gets round to creating Eve. Now, this isn't the first incident of its type. There are two flood stories and two calls to Moses. So if Moses is writing this down, you've got to wonder what he's playing at. But check this out. In Deuteronomy, it tells us that Moses writes about his death before it happens. So Moses, the servant of the Lord, died there in the land of Moab according to the word of the Lord. Now, unless he's doing a Tupac Shakur, how could he write about his death before it actually happens? Naturally, I'm not the first person to ask these questions. Tradition says that Moses wrote the first five books of the Bible. How likely is that?
It's not very likely, actually. Partly because Moses would then be speaking about his own death. At least from the medieval period, we have rabbis already wondering if there are parts of the Torah that Moses didn't write. But it wasn't really until the 19th century that we find a German scholar by the name of Wellhausen who came up with a theory that suggested there are actually four different literary sources that underlie the Pentateuch.
I'm surprised by how calm Jill is about this. Four different sources? Then Moses can't have written it at all, and believers have been hoodwinked for centuries. But it's true. There are four original sources of the text, and each of them has its own distinctive style and agenda. Academics give each of the versions a letter. J, or the Yahwist, because he called God Yahweh. E, which called him Elohim. P, or the priestly source. And D, named after the book of Deuteronomy. If I was reading through the first five books, what kind of characteristics would identify all of these four sources? So what would identify J, for example?
Of all the four sources, the Yahwist tells stories the best. They're elaborate, they're detailed, they have a lot of emotion. The Yahwist has God dealing with people directly. So in Exodus 3, Yahweh's version, God himself is going to be freeing the people from Egypt. So he said, I have come down to rescue them from the land of the Egyptians and to bring them up out of that land. But in E, God mediated his relationship to people through angels or dreams so that there was no immediate relationship between people and God in E. And so you have the burning bush. Because God couldn't speak directly to Moses, he had to use an intermediary. So you find the burning bush in E's story. P, which is the priestly version, has a great deal of interest in things like law, priestly affairs, sacrifice, those types of issues. And the Deuteronomist has a real focus on monotheism. There do seem to be very clear distinctions between the different stories that we have.
I was taught to read the Bible as a single factual account. Now we learn that the scriptures disagree on the very nature of God. One says he speaks to us direct, the other says he uses intermediaries. In other words, a very different Old Testament indeed. How come, if this is true, the church has taught for centuries that Moses wrote the first five books of the Bible? Isn't this a contradiction?
Not necessarily. Because what you still have is that you have a historicity that was written down in certain periods by people who fundamentally believed in their God. But then when you put them all together, what you're suggesting is that everyone's experiences is okay, because it's all the same God working in that history. And so that no one history is actually valid over the other, that all together, somehow, they give you a closer understanding of who God is and what our relationship to God is.
What's absolutely clear is that the Bible is a big editing job. Rather than having one author, Moses, there are four anonymous versions, J, D, E, and P, and they arise from different parts of Israelite society. Worse still, there are different opinions on how God behaves. And to top all of that, theologians and academics have known this for some time, but the details haven't filtered out into the churches, and you've got to wonder why. But what I want to know was who brought these four versions together, and more intriguingly, why? Archaeology has pinpointed when the four sources of the Torah, as the Jews called the books of Moses, may have come together. Many of the buildings on the city of David were built at the end of the 8th century BC. And in those 8th century layers, the archaeologists found a lot of inscribed jewels, which were used for sealing letters and marking property. Real hard evidence of the widespread literacy needed to edit a complex book. By that time, the northern kingdom of Israel had been swept away by the Assyrian Empire. The small southern kingdom of Judah came into its own. In Jerusalem, the capital, Yahweh was the chief god, but even according to the Bible, there were other religious cults. Is this the background to the creation of the Torah, a book to unite a divided community with different religious traditions? One of Israel's leading biblical experts is a member of this rundown synagogue in Tel Aviv.
I do believe that, let's say, most of the Torah, the five books of Moses, the scroll that we are holding right now, was written in the 7th century. Major parts of it have been written earlier, but it reached a semi-final form in the 7th century BC.
Zakovich's evidence comes from the Psalms, the Old Testament's hymn book, which scholars believe was written before 586 BC, when the kingdom of Judah was destroyed.
When I read Psalm 78, which believes still that Judah will last there forever, I can see that the author of this psalm is actually making a great mosaic. He is using different traditions from the Torah for different documents, J, E, D, and P. And all of them, I can trace the footprints of all four of them in this psalm, for instance. These are the verses about the manna down from heaven. And here again, he combines the tradition from Exodus and the tradition from the book of Numbers. He's very free about it.
To tell the story of the Israelites, the author of the psalm is deliberately choosing episodes from all four sources and weaving them together into a single story. It's all coming together. Both the textual study and the archaeology point to a single date. The Old Testament as we know it goes back to the end of the 8th or the 7th century BC. But why then did the four different writings converge? And why in Jerusalem? The Bible itself tells us, the king in Jerusalem at the time was called Hezekiah, and he started a religious revolution all about a new idea of God.
He removed the high places and brake the images and cut down the groves and brake in pieces the brazen serpent that Moses had made. For he clave to the Lord and departed not from following him.
So Hezekiah outlawed the other cults and brought in monotheism, the belief in one God. And the Bible had to hard sell the idea.
We are talking about two great kings. One of them was Hezekiah, the second one was Josiah. We, the kings of Jerusalem, decide what's legitimate and what's not legitimate. You can't worship God any way you want. There is no room anymore for many different temples all over the country, but there is one specific place, which is Jerusalem, where you should worship God.
So the Bible is about establishing one God and one Jerusalem temple, but the various original versions had tales that weren't quite on message. So why didn't the Bible writers just get rid of them?
Whenever a text was written down, people believed that it was a holy text, they should preserve it. Even when they didn't agree with it, still they preserved it.
But who actually wrote it down?
We are talking about a very thin layers of intellectuals who know the traditions, who know the writings of each other, that they interpreted one another when they didn't agree with one another. So let's say that a person wrote a piece of D in his own times. Then comes a person who represents the school of P, the priestly code, who doesn't agree with what has been written by the D writer, and he writes his own piece, interprets it, and it goes on and on and on, this dialogue. And this way, the Torah kept growing and becoming bigger and bigger, like a snowball.
So it wasn't who wrote the Bible, but who rewrote the Bible. The four versions were being revised, edited, and updated to fit a particular theological and political point of view, the monotheism of Jerusalem. What I once thought was the Word of God was now beginning to sound like something out of Stalin's Russia. I want to know more about King Hezekiah, the man who turned the Bible into a party political manifesto for monotheism. He definitely knew something about spin. In Hezekiah's time, the most fearsome conquerors were the Assyrians. And in the heart of the British Museum is a dramatic sculpture of the Assyrian attack on one of Hezekiah's towns, Lachish. The episode is mentioned in the Bible, but also in Assyrian records, so we can check the spin. According to the sculpture, it was a hard-fought victory for the Assyrians.
They have battering rams here, with a great spike on the front here. These square blocks here are probably bits of masonry from the battlements and from the structure here, raining down on the Assyrians, throwing everything at them in order to prevent their attack succeeding. The biblical account tells us that the Assyrians also went to the capital city of Jerusalem. And the biblical account tells us that for some reason the Assyrians were smitten in the night and withdrew. And this was therefore claimed as a great victory then for Judah and for Hezekiah. But the Assyrian textual account doesn't mention Jerusalem at all. What we do know from the Assyrian sources is that Hezekiah had to pay pretty hefty tribute in terms of precious vessels, gold and silver, to buy off or to buy himself a little bit more time.
So in reality, it was only spared because they had to buy off the Assyrians, and that's not recorded in the biblical text.
That's absolutely right. There are differences and there are issues of spin. And in one case, the Assyrians need it for their purposes. They are putting this all over their palace. They're not mentioning what happened to Jerusalem. As far as the Judahites are concerned, they needed this to turn it into a great victory, so that Hezekiah comes out as the great champion.
All this was more than 2,000 years ago. The Bible's promoting Hezekiah's Judaism, but it's not the Judaism we know today.
It's already a monotheistic religion. He really cleaned the temple and got rid of all the popular elements. But still, it's not Judaism, of course, the way we practice it here in this synagogue.
What's surprisingly modern is the system of tithes or taxes which supported the temple. There are passages in Deuteronomy that suggest if people pay their tithes and have their sacrifices in Jerusalem, that God will bless them. Is that part of the ideology of centralizing the cult?
Yes, of course. Look, the people who wanted to promote the Deuteronomistic ideology, of course, that's their way to convince the people that that's the way for them to become blessed.
So the Old Testament writers made it clear, pay service to the temple and God would see you right. This ancient bargain is still a powerful force in religion today.
Everybody in here, listen to this.
Like many evangelical churches, the Ruach Foundation in Brixton put a lot of emphasis on giving money to the church, just as the Old Testament says, and on the rewards which will result.
So now 2004 is the year of the open door. I shall keep on decreeing until you go through your open door. Everything that God promised you, you shall have.
The Bible commends us and commands us to give. And when he says give, it actually says that something will come back to you. You know, it shall be given back to you, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. With full measure shall it be given back to you. So there is a spiritual implication in giving, that we are obeying God's word. And in doing so, not only is it spiritual, but then it becomes very practical as well.
But there's a difference between Brixton and Hezekiah's Jerusalem cult. In Brixton, religious practice isn't the main thing. It's about giving of yourself, giving of your time, giving of your expertise, as well as putting money into the offering plate. Now, that idea of salvation through sacrifice wasn't in Hezekiah's Bible. But it would get there, though, because there was yet another rewrite of the Bible to come. And this one was based on a disaster that took place in the late 7th century BC. After Hezekiah, another king, Josiah, became the great hope for the Jews. In 609 BC, he came here to Megiddo, known then as Armageddon. The word has survived since because of the fateful meeting between Josiah and Necho, the Egyptian pharaoh.
We don't know exactly what happened here, and we don't know exactly where it happened. But the fact of the matter is that the meeting ended in a very tragic way, because Necho simply killed Josiah at Megiddo. That was a terrible blow for Judah and for the ideology of the biblical authors. King Josiah, the most righteous king in the history of Judah, according to their description, the center of their hopes for a revival of all Israel, for the revival of the great kingdom of the past and so on, was slaughtered here at Megiddo all of a sudden, and everything collapsed.
In less than a generation, Jerusalem and its temple would be destroyed and the population exiled. So the Bible had a new job to do. It had to offer hope for the future.
This is the moment when you have the beginning of Messianism and the idea that the next righteous king from the lineage of David will come back from the same place where the last one was slaughtered by Necho. So the idea of Armageddon starts here in 609 BC.
No longer were the Jews in control of their own land. They were exiles, suffering servants. But their Bible continued to evolve. Now prophesying the Messiah and the new world he would bring, the Old Testament we know today was finally taking shape. The population of Israel today is some 6 million. A high proportion of first-generation immigrants. Since 1989 alone, more than 1 million people have become new Israeli citizens. But most Israelis don't regard themselves as plain immigrants. They are, they say, exiles returning to their promised land. This is not the first time Jews have returned to the Holy Land. In 516 BC, after more than 50 years in exile in Babylon, Jews returned to rebuild the temple in Jerusalem. Today, what remains of the temple is the object of veneration for religious Israelis.
This place is full of contradictions. You've got a wall and people treating it as sacred ground and feeling that their God is present here, yet we're told that the same God doesn't dwell in temples made by human hands. It's a place of devotion, deep, profound religious devotion, yet there are soldiers against the wall with their guns praying there. I mean, could you imagine that happening in a church? People bringing weapons into a church to pray to God. So it's a place of incredible contrasts and tensions.
Modern Zionism relies on the Bible. Just as the book of Jeremiah foretold the return of the original exiles from Babylon, so the Bible's promises lie behind the establishment of the Israeli state. The experience of exile transformed Jewish identity, but it also changed the Old Testament. In 516, the final rewrite of the Bible begins. It contains material written in exile far from the land of Israel, and it deals with the themes of suffering and affliction. How could God allow the military defeat to take place and the subsequent exile and torture in the land of Babylon? It now becomes a book that's concerned with suffering and liberation. And it doesn't just explore the themes of triumph, but now the concern of terror. And that's what makes the Bible such a universal book. Where does this come from? Next stop, the Shrine of the Book in Jerusalem, and some of the oldest Bible manuscripts in the world.
My name's Robert Beckford. I've come to see Israel Null.
The visionary new ideas come not in the books of Moses, which start the Old Testament, but from the books of the prophets you find at the back, especially Isaiah. Significantly, the oldest existing copy of a whole book of the Bible is not a copy of the Torah, it's the book of Isaiah. And in it, Isaiah adds a whole new dimension to the Bible, the idea of the Messiah and a new Eden.
Isaiah comes with a remarkable new idea. Eden is going to appear again in the end of days. With the vision of all nations, not just Israel, are coming to Jerusalem seeking the word of God.
Isaiah lived in the 8th century BC, before the exile. He believed the new world would be brought into being by a great Messiah or chosen one.
For Isaiah, the Messiah is the person who will come from the house of David at the end of days. And in his time, as there will be this peace between the lion and the lamb, and he will judge his nation and the other nations in peace.
During the exile, the book of Isaiah was continued by someone else. And in the process, a startling new idea emerged of Israel redeemed through suffering and rejection. This idea was a way of dealing with the problem of how the God of Jerusalem had allowed the exile to happen.
We suffer in order to atone for the sins of the nations. This is why we suffer. The sin of the nations is their worship of idols. And we are punished for their sin. But it is not only that they suffer for the nations in order to atone for them, they have a mission. And this is something that we see in many verses in this scroll. I send you now, my servant Israel, to the nations to bring light to them, to teach them about the God of Israel, who is going now to be God of all nations. And this, he continues the ideas of first Isaiah.
With the idea of a mission and a Messiah, I think that's the moment the Bible truly becomes a universal document. It stops being a book just for the Jews, and by offering hope for the future, becomes a book for everyone, because we all want a future of peace and security. The idea that one's own suffering isn't just redemptive for you, but redemptive for everyone, is truly amazing. And it's at the heart of the teachings of Martin Luther King. So what next? How far could the Bible go? How much more could it be updated and amended? In 1947, there was an amazing discovery. A Bedouin shepherd stumbled across some ancient scrolls concealed in a cave by the Dead Sea. Judging by the handwriting, the scrolls had been produced about 100 years before the birth of Christ by an extreme Jewish sect called the Essenes. So hardline, they even dared to rewrite the Bible itself. This, the Temple Scroll, is a revised, rewritten edition of the Torah of the books of Moses. And it irons out all the inconsistencies which derive from the different versions. So why aren't these Dead Sea Scrolls part of the Bible today?
This man is continuing Moses without any fear. But, you know, the rest of the people of Israel in this period saw things completely different. For them, the canon was sealed. No prophecy anymore, no revelation anymore. Any efforts to continue the revelation of the biblical period with creation of new revisions and new books is going to be rejected.
So the rewriting is over. It's absolutely amazing how sacred books are created. In this synagogue, as is the case in every synagogue around the world, the scrolls of the Torah are kept in a sacred place, the tabernacle. And these are the privileged texts. You can comment on them, but you can't change them. And around 100 BC, the Jews decided that this was their Bible. But once you've completed the sacred book, you can't then pick and choose which bits are or are not the Word of God. That can lead you to some dangerous places.
A heavenly voice came out and said, Abraham, this is the entrance to paradise. And the heavenly voice says, this here is the burial place of Adam and Eve. A place that connects our physical world with the higher spiritual world. The entrance to paradise.
We're on the road to Hebron. I'm going to meet a rabbi there, Rabbi Simcha Hochbaum, who is a Jewish rabbi in the Jewish settlement there. I'm really interested in meeting him because I want to know how he reads the Old Testament. According to the book of Genesis, the patriarch Abraham is buried in Hebron, so the West Bank town is sacred to both Jews and Muslims. The present tomb of Abraham was originally built by King Herod for the Jews. Then it became a mosque. It now houses a synagogue as well. The Jewish community here was expelled during riots in 1929. Only after 1967 did Jewish settlers return. As extreme Zionists, they believe their rights here are laid down in the Hebrew Bible.
We believe every word of the Bible to be divinely ordained, God giving it to Moses and being written down for all future generations. The Torah describes in great detail in chapter 23 in the book of Genesis the purchase of the cave, the field surrounding it, Abraham negotiating with the children of Chet and Ephron, the mayor of Hebron, and the purchase of this place. Within each and every one of us lies the belief. Sometimes the belief may be covered up with science or with technology, intellectual pursuit, but deep, deep down, every Jew knows and every Jew believes.
It's 8 p.m. that night and there's a wedding in the square. But it's more than just a family or religious occasion, it's also deeply political. The bridegroom is the great-grandson of one of the founding fathers of the settler movement. Here, beneath the walls of the tomb of Abraham, are the true believers. God said this was their land.
Once the Arabs kicked us out of here with shame, yet here we are now, gathering for prayer. We hope, with God's help, that one day Hebron will be full of Jews.
In Hebron, there is absolutely no compromise on how you read the Bible and who you think wrote it. You must have heard that there are scholars who argue that the Torah has four sources, not one. How would you respond to that?
I'm not familiar with their opinions, but it's very sad that that someone wouldn't believe, and someone could be so naive and not believe in the divinity of the Bible, and it's being ordained from God to Moses onto the Jewish people. This is something that's very sad because it's one of our fundamental beliefs and principal beliefs, and our whole existence and whole essence as a Jewish nation and a Jewish people is based upon that principle and based upon that belief of the divinity of the Torah.
Is there a connection between you returning here to the land and what's written in the Bible?
Of course there's a connection. We are right now living out the prophecies that God spoke to Isaiah, that God promised us both in the Torah and the prophets and the scriptures, of how one day the Jewish people will come from a faraway land after persecution. And we've seen, since the rise of the State of Israel, the influx of Jews from four corners of the world.
I think it's truly, truly, and remarkably, the fulfillment of a prophecy in our own times and own days. And of course, when it comes to this big question of biblical borders, it's guided by the Bible and the divine promise.
I don't know what to make of it, but I'm disturbed by it because he didn't want to engage with the scholarship. He actually felt sorry for the people. I mean, that's kind of patronizing and naive. You know, these people who have dedicated their lives to working with the text and trying to understand it. So to find somebody who just wants to blank, not engage with it in this context is really quite disturbing. Most Israeli Jews disagree with fundamentalists like Simcat and the settlers. But I think he and people like him read the Bible basically as an imperialist book, justifying their politics. Just a short drive through the hills, there are people who are completely opposed to the settlers, but who believe in the same Bible stories. I'm on my way to Bethlehem, which is under Palestinian control and is separated from Jerusalem by this big, massive wall. The reason I'm going there is because the story of the Exodus, while it's sacred to the Jews, also matters to Palestinians, and these ones are Christians. Bethlehem has been a center for Christian devotion ever since the Gospels describe the birth of Jesus in a stable there. But its biblical history goes back much further. It's also said to have been the birthplace of King David. The Basilica of the Nativity is a Greek Orthodox church, but here every day the Bible is chanted not in Greek, but in Arabic.
It was built first in the 4th century by Queen Helena, and then it was rebuilt again in the 6th century, and it is still the same shape as it was built.
In accepting the Jewish Old Testament, Palestinian Christians are accepting with it the Exodus story, one of the foundations of Judaism and the basis of Zionism. Don't you feel you're taking on the story of your oppressor? And if that's the case, will it ever set you free?
What does it mean as a Christian today, living in Palestine under occupation by somebody who's using that particular book to say, I'm not supposed to be? Now, turn it on the other side, and I say, no, because that book says, no human being, even in that book said the Jews, but it gave the right for the people of God to seek liberation. And we are the people of God too. We're not people of a lesser God.
Nua Kori is a Lutheran Protestant. Her friend Nastas is Greek Orthodox. For both of them, that flexibility extends even beyond their own Bible.
I feel, as a Palestinian, that there is no disconnectedness between the Bible, the New Testament, the Quran, you know, this is the land of the Palestinian people. The story of the Exodus, you can take it, this is part of our story of our great-great-great-grandfathers, both as Jews, Muslims, and Christians in this land. Or you can say this is one of the stories of some of the people who lived on this land, but all of them are connected.
That connection is witness to the inspiring power of the Hebrew Bible. It has never stopped generating new ideas. In fact, just as the Old Testament was becoming complete, the ideas of the new one were beginning amongst the writers of the Dead Sea Scrolls. The link can be found in what is called the Thanksgiving Scroll. In it, a desert hardliner describes himself in a way that to any Christian will seem incredibly familiar.
He is saying about himself, I am sitting in heaven, surrounded by angels. This is exactly how Jesus is describing himself in the New Testament, seeing himself with divine quality, but at the same time, suffering servant. And this combination of divinity and suffering was unknown in the Old Testament.
This is the moment when the Old Testament meets the New. The fruition of Judaism and the beginning of Christianity. The writing of the New Testament is a completely new project. It's based on the Old Testament, but uses a new revelation. Now, when I was a child, I was taught to read the New Testament as the writings of Jesus' disciples. It was an accurate account of his life and death, and it was the fulfillment of the divine promise because the Messiah had now come. But given all that I've learnt about the Old Testament, I need to be critical of what they taught me. Is the gospel really gospel truth? How accurate is it? I need to discover who wrote the New Testament. I journeyed through the Holy Land and found that the work of the Old Testament writers was far from straightforward God-given history. But millions of people, even the most powerful man on earth, the US President George W. Bush, believe that the New Testament is built on much firmer ground. It is, they say, a reliable report of what really happened in the days of one man. And I wanted to find out whether that could be true. The Via Dolorosa in Jerusalem. Just over 2,000 years ago, a Jew called Jesus walked this very road to his death. So says the Bible, and that's why these people have come here, to retrace his steps. Back then and today, people believe this Jesus was himself prophesied in the pages of the Old Testament.
This is why people do this. I mean, this is historical for people. They have to go reenact, they have to go live what they believe to be true.
Jesus was, they believe, the promised Christ, a Greek word meaning Messiah. And from here on, the Bible itself was going to document his story.
Has anyone not carried the cross that would like to?
The Church of the Holy Sepulchre is the climax. It's said to house the most important places in all Christianity. Why? Because people believe the Bible says it literally happened here. There's Calvary, where Jesus was crucified. The anointing stone where he was embalmed. And then, of course, there's the tomb itself, the site of the resurrection. It feels very emotional to be here, but at the same time, you realize that all this is down to what the Gospels say real eyewitnesses saw.
Never in my wildest dreams did I ever believe that I would be able to walk this Holy Land.
So the Bible for you, the stories in the New Testament, would be accurate eyewitness accounts of what's happened?
Now they are, yes. This is a big step for me to be able to come to the Holy Land and witness this.
The New Testament and the accounts of Jesus for you,
yes,
are accurate.
Absolutely, absolutely. And what was true then is even more alive today.
I'm just looking at what's in the New Testament. It's not as long as the Old Testament, and there are 21 letters, the book of Revelation and the Acts of the Apostles, which is early church history. And then there's the Gospels, the meat of the New Testament. And that's why those pilgrims went all the way to Jerusalem, because they believe in the Gospels 100%. They believe them to be actual reportage, that the disciples have faithfully recorded everything that they've seen and heard. First Matthew, Mark, Luke, and then John. But as I found out, that's not really how it happened at all. In actual fact, the business of writing down the New Testament got kick-started not in the Holy Land, but somewhere else altogether, and by somebody who'd never met Jesus. His name was Paul, and 14 of the letters in the second part of the New Testament are attributed to him. At last, a real biblical writer with a real name. Paul did lots of his writing out in modern-day Turkey. Even though he was the first to put pen to paper about Christianity, Paul himself started out in the years after Jesus' death as a Jewish establishment hardliner who even persecuted early Christians. That's according to his biography, laid out in the New Testament book of Acts. But, so the story goes, one blinding flash and vision of the risen Jesus later, Paul was a changed man. He now believed that Jesus had asked him personally to take the Christian message from the Jewish world out to the Gentiles of the Roman Empire. So he set sail, heading west, and ended up in this place, Ephesus.
Paul first arrived in Ephesus by boat, so he would have come by boat to where we are behind us here, and actually there would be water further behind us because this would be looking onto the harbour. So Paul would have disembarked there and walked up this road into the city. Ephesus was like many other pagan cities of Paul's day, full of gods, full of people worshipping at temples, full of people buying and selling.
Just a couple of hours after I arrived, this place was teeming with day trippers, which isn't too different from what it would have been like in the time of Paul. A temple town and trading center, always buzzing with tourists. But being there gave me a real sense of how much courage Paul had. Paul had guts. He's just converted, but he doesn't hide away. He immediately turns up in a big city to spread the gospel, even if that did get people's backs up.
I like to think of Paul as something like a boxer who keeps getting knocked down continually, but keeps getting back up, takes more punishment, keeps on going with the fight. He's zealous, he's ardent, he's fervent for the faith. He's a fanatic for the gospel.
Fanatic's a dirty word these days, but back then, it seems to have been what drove Paul to start writing. Not that he bothered with Jesus' story as such. Instead, he wrote a kind of rule book for the early church.
He began writing as a troubleshooting exercise. He went around the country founding churches in different cities and different places, and he couldn't be in all of those places at any one time. So therefore, his means of addressing a problem when it cropped up in a church was to send a letter. Paul has a mentality which is similar to the Old Testament prophets. He feels that he's writing the word of the Lord. It's the word of the Lord for a particular situation, but nevertheless, he feels that he is writing with God's or the Spirit's insight.
Paul is responsible for more of the New Testament than anyone else, writing in Greek and laying down the law about everything from the importance of obedience to government to the sanctity of love. But God wasn't the only influence on his work.
Almost certainly, all Paul's letters were written by a scribe, not by Paul himself. We know this because right at the end of 1 Corinthians, Paul says, "I write this greeting in my own hand." Now, that implies that everything that's gone before has been penned by someone else.
So how do we know that the scribe didn't have a laugh and put in stuff that shouldn't be there?
The scribe was allowed to have an influence, could on occasion have an influence on the content and the style of the letter produced. But it's very difficult to distinguish Paul from the scribe's input.
After 2 years here, Paul and his scribe left Ephesus bound in the end for Rome. And that's where I'm heading next. My impression of Paul is that he's a key worker, a servant. That's why he begins every letter with Paul, a servant of Christ. Paul's a Jesus hustler. He wants to get the message of the gospel out there and is willing to do whatever it takes, no matter how menial. But Paul ends up going to Rome, the seat of power, and it's at that point he becomes one of the powerless. He's put in prison and persecuted, and it's then he realizes what it means to be one of the downtrodden.
Thank you.
In the late 60s AD, here in Rome, Paul is thought to have been executed by the very authorities he himself had warned against, part of a wave of Christian persecution. But the terror of these days also sparked an extraordinary idea, something that had never occurred to Paul: to write Jesus' own story down. I'm reading about the birth of Jesus, the Christmas story. Now, most people think that there's one account found in all four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. But that's not the case. In Matthew's account, we have the story of the star in the east and the wise men, but there's no angel, no manger, and no shepherds. They come from Luke. And in Mark's account, there's no birth story at all. Jesus just begins his ministry as a young man. And in John's account, the same thing happens, but he starts it off in a totally different location. This raises all kinds of questions, the first one being accuracy. I mean, if a crime takes place and the police have four different eyewitness accounts, they're going to wonder if one is accurate and the rest are false. The second question is, were these people actually there? Were they really eyewitnesses? Or is this simply a case of a Christian version of Chinese whispers? Four different accounts, the same event, raises a whole whack of questions. To find answers, you need to go back to the very beginning. Beneath this church in Rome lies an ancient catacomb. Here, the earliest persecuted Christians buried their dead in secret. It had started 34 years after Christ's death, when the Emperor Nero was looking for scapegoats for the great fire of Rome. He pointed the finger at the Christians, and at his word, the killing began. Many believe that it's from this persecuted community that the very first gospel writer emerged, sometime around 70 AD. Mark.
We don't know precisely who Mark is. He doesn't sort of sign his book at the end and say, this is where I've come from, this is who I am. But you can pick up clues from the gospel about who he is. It's quite possible that Mark, like many of the other Christians in this period, actually has personally experienced persecution. He's very realistic and gritty. You know, you can smell the dirt and the blood in Mark's gospel. In some ways, it's because of the persecution that Mark wants to write the first gospel, because you've got to try and make sense of it. And what better way of making sense of it than telling the story of the first real martyr of this new faith, Jesus himself?
Mark may have known persecution, but what did he know firsthand about Jesus himself?
The thing is, when you're looking at the Gospels, we don't know it's true. There are no independent archaeological records where you can check things up. No one was out there with a camcorder, you know, recording these things. There wasn't even anyone taking notes, as far as we know. So a lot of it we're being asked to take on trust. I don't think Mark himself is an eyewitness. For it's not, he never actually says, I did this, I did the other. So he's not even claiming to be an eyewitness. But what I think you do find in Mark's Gospel is some quite interesting reminiscences from some of the earliest people that were involved with Jesus himself. People like Peter, James and John, they've talked to people, and these oral traditions have found their way to Mark.
That the first gospel writer was relying on hearsay is a bit of a thunderbolt. Then you realise that lots of Jesus' story isn't even there in the earliest Mark manuscripts. No nativity, no long sermons, no resurrection appearances. In the end, it's less a record of events than a self-help guide that says suffering and persecution are the best way to God.
Mark is the creative genius that gets this whole process of writing Gospels going. In a way, it's quite an arrogant, quite a conceited thing to do, to say, I'm going to do an authoritative version of this story. It has a kind of propaganda purpose, I think.
Mark's big idea took off. A decade or more later, over in Antioch in Syria, another man turned his hand to writing Jesus' story. But this time, it's a PR campaign for a very different kind of Christ.
Well, most people might think first off that Matthew's Gospel is written by Matthew, the tax collector, one of the 12 disciples. When you look at the document carefully, you see that the Gospel doesn't look like the product of an eyewitness. So who is this character? Well, the most important thing of all about Matthew is this is clearly a Jewish writer that knows all about the habits and the ways and the laws of Judaism.
Rather than go back to the drawing board, Matthew started by copying large chunks of Mark's Gospel, then rewriting or adding his own bits.
In the ancient world, there's no copyright laws, and you can just copy stuff out, and Matthew does. I mean, sometimes word for word.
Isn't this just plagiarism?
I think the thing is, you'd have to say that if Matthew was writing today, you could take into court for plagiarism. There's no question about it. What Matthew, I think, is trying to do is supplant Mark. He's trying to take it over. Matthew thinks that Mark's picture of Jesus isn't quite right. He knows that Jesus was a Jew, and he knows that Jesus was more Jewish than Mark is inclined to paint him. So, if you like, he goes through the process of almost re-Judaizing Jesus and making him more Jewish.
So Matthew adds the Christmas story, the Sermon on the Mount, and the Lord's Prayer, all pointing to Jesus as the fulfillment of the Old Testament prophecies. And this is probably why his book ends up with top billing in the New Testament.
So is Matthew the first salesman of a Jewish Jesus?
I think so. I think one of the things he wants to do is he wants to make Jesus a son of Abraham, a son of David, paint him like Moses.
Most people read this gospel as history, but you're suggesting it's propaganda. How do you hold that together as a Christian?
I think the thing is, it's not a case of either or. It's not a case of just because something's got a bit of spin, just because something's trying to tell a particular story to a particular group of people, that it's not got any history in it.
By this point in the late 1st century AD, the tone's been set for the Gospels, and it was all about being a consummate spin doctor. Like Luke, an educated man based in Greece, Luke focuses on taking the Bible into the mainstream of the Roman Empire, writing not just the Gospel, but the book of Acts too, describing the spread of Christianity from Jerusalem to Rome.
Luke wants to tell the whole world that this Christian religion is reputable, it's okay. He's trying to say, look, it might sound nutty, this stuff. It's about some Jewish carpenter in some backwater. But he's saying, no, Christianity is respectable. It is the kind of thing that a civilized, middle-class kind of Roman citizen like me can believe in. It's something which is right there at the heart of the empire. And Luke really paves the way for Christianity becoming a Roman imperial religion.
The spin of the last Gospels are most obvious. It was written by a Jew called John, who's kicked out of the synagogue in Paul's old city, Ephesus, at the end of the 1st century. And by writing extra, slightly unreal speeches for Jesus, John's peddling a specific new angle.
Why the need for a fourth gospel?
Because John wrote a gospel, we've got to assume that he must have been dissatisfied with the others in some way. I suspect that the thing that he didn't like about them was that they didn't quite get their vision of Jesus right. The Jesus in the other Gospels is not quite, if you like, divine enough.
So isn't he just rewriting history?
I think that the author of John's Gospel is definitely meditating on these events and thinking about them and kind of working them, rejigging them a little bit for his own time. I mean, is he actually, in some of these things, actually, if you like, making things up? Well, I think he would see it as being inspired by the Holy Spirit to put into writing some of these things that the other writers of the Gospels haven't actually got to the heart of.
This all seemed totally opposite to what I was brought up to believe as a kid, and what only the other day all those pilgrims I met in Jerusalem were counting on. So the question for me now as a believer is whether it discredits the Gospels if they're not just simple reportage. One of the things I've learned from being in Rome is that you can't read the Gospels literally. They're not meant to be read as eyewitness accounts. We don't know what really happened, but maybe we don't need to, because if we see these texts as an attempt by a community to work out what's happening in its life by reflecting on the life of Jesus, then we can see them as books of faith. They aim to communicate faith. So it seems to me, if you read the Gospels as straightforward historical fact, then it's just as dangerous as reading the Old Testament that way, because you're going to miss the point of what they're really about. So it's back to England to talk to a guy who's transformed himself from underworld villain to born-again Christian, simply by reading and believing the New Testament Gospels.
Shouldn't they get a blinkered attitude that maybe Christians are a weak type of person and they're like a wimp and you're walking along with an old duffel coat and sandals and you won't say boot to a goose?
Now, to me, the boxers and the drug dealers and the drug addicts and the villains and the gangsters are entitled to hear the gospel of Jesus.
Former criminal Alan Mortlock is, so he says, an evangelist to the underworld. He's now a North London boxing promoter who claims 14 years ago, God's word saved him from a life of crime.
I love fighting. I was a street fighter, and the trouble that I got into was violence, even at an early age.
And what do you go to prison for?
Causing an affray, malicious wounding, and two assaults.
Someone give me six.
Hardly you'd think a man of God. But that was about to change. In December 1990, Alan had a vision.
In the middle of whatever time it was, I woke up, and as I woke up, to the right of my bedroom, I could see a grey cloud of smoke. And in the mist, I saw the eyes, the nose and the mouth of a man looking down at me. It frightened the life out of me, and I've got to be honest with you, I've had a 38 Smith & Wesson gun in my temple with a man's hand shaking like this. So I looked at the hand and I thought to myself, I hope he don't sneeze, because if he sneezes, he's going to blow my head right off my shoulders. Yet what was happening in my bedroom phased me out even more, because I knew it was from the supernatural.
From that day on, the Bible became the most important book in Alan's life. But what about my research in Rome on the Gospels? Does Alan really need to read them as historical record?
The Bible, to me, is the handbook. It is the highway code of life. And I believe that if you want to learn about life and how you should lead your life and how you should deal with people, and how the Bible also is a book of power that can help you as a person, to me, that Bible is the book of my handbook of life.
Who wrote the Bible for you? Was it God or man?
God. Yeah, it was God. Man wrote it down in the physical, but to me, I believe that God was the inspiration that spoke to them, man. It's God's word. The Bible, to me, is God's word.
Does that mean when you read the New Testament, you read it as the literal word of God?
The literal word of God.
Yeah. So you believe that, for example, Matthew was a disciple who wrote down what he saw?
I believe so, yeah. I believe so, yes.
What if I was to say to you that they were written down years, decades after the life of Jesus and not eyewitness accounts?
That night in my house, God showed me and come into me and showed me that he was real. Now, if the Bible, which I believe is God's word, I believe that Matthew is exactly where he says he was at that time. And it wouldn't matter to me, and I'm not disrespectful to the professors and all that, but it wouldn't matter what they said. To me, they were there at that time.
All right, work. Come on, work.
I'd never knock Alan's faith. Whichever way you look at it, he's been saved for sure. But you wonder whether these problems of authorship have provoked any soul-searching in the upper ranks of the Anglican Church, people like the Bishop of Durham. Bishop Tom, for you, who wrote the Bible?
The Bible is, of course, a human book constructed by men and women, but equally, Christians have always said it's a divine book in that God intended them to write what they did, and that, of course, plunges you straight into the middle of the classic theological question as to how humans and God are both responsible for the same thing at the same time, and that's, as with Jesus being both human and divine, that's one of the oldest mysteries in the book.
If none of the writers are eyewitnesses, doesn't that undermine their authority and credibility?
I think even if none of the Gospels were actually written by eyewitnesses, we can certainly track back very easily and effectively to the real Jesus. We often forget how oral cultures work because we live in a print culture, a mass media culture, and in their sort of culture, the sort of stories that people tell, particularly when they're life-changing stories, they tell them again and again and again and again until they're deeply part of the fabric of who they are, and then a whole community tells those stories and bang, you've got large connected narratives that actually everybody knows.
It seems to me that what you're saying is that when you read it, therefore, you're reading it as being truthful and accurate. So Jesus, when we're told Jesus walks on the water, for you that's real.
And I'm not sure what the word real means, because it's a slippery word. Yes, I'm perfectly happy to say that it happened. I'm also, because I basically believe that God can do whatever God wants to do. And of course our culture has balked at some of that. We won't believe in somebody walking on the water. Well, that's our bad luck. We've got to do business with what's there.
Each writer has a perspective, an angle, sometimes an axe to grind. Is it fair to say that what they're doing is spinning the gospel?
All writers write from a perspective, from a point of view, just like if you set up a video camera to record every single thing that happens on the street, you may see something that's exciting. The chances are most of what you see will be really rather boring and tedious and humdrum. So, of course, they're selecting and arranging. And if you want to call that spin, fair enough, as long as you realize that it's what we all do all the time. In other words, this is not a devious, cunning manipulation of events. They're telling the story in such a way as to bring out the flavor, to bring out the meaning. And, okay, it's the meaning that they see, but that does not mean that the things didn't happen or that Jesus never said it. It's really time to grow up beyond this rather sterile either-or of either it was just a snapshot at the time or somebody made it up later. It's much richer than that.
Strong words. But surely this cast-iron belief that the Bible is above reproach owes a lot to the awesome authority of the book itself. And I can't help wondering how that's come about. This is one of the major print works for Bible production in Britain today, a far cry from the 2nd century AD, when thousands of scribes copied the original scrolls of the New Testament Gospels or letters over and over again. The only way of publishing back then. But a bigger leap than all this machinery is the fact that today the Bible is a single book with a definitive list of chapters and a fixed order, always the same.
I think most people would be deeply shocked and surprised to find out that the Bible just doesn't appear as a book. After all, it's holy scripture, and holy usually means that it drops out of the sky or it drips off the mouth and tongue of God. But the real shocker is the fact that about 200 years after Jesus, there aren't just four Gospels and the other books that make up the New Testament, but literally dozens of Gospels and dozens of letters, all with different interpretations of events and all jockeying for position. So, in terms of compiling the Bible, there's still a long way to go from having lots of texts written on papyri in different languages to ending up with the Bible, a modern-day bestseller with a shiny front cover, available for people to read in English at a store near you.
Not that everyone had the chance to read scripture back then, with only 10% literacy.
We still must remember that most people throughout this whole period would be hearing the Bible read out. And the scholars would be reading it and studying it, and the preachers and so on. But the people would be hearing them read, not accessing the book themselves. Individual leaders in certain cities have the power of being the main teaching bishop in that city to teach the Bible and instruct people in which parts of the Bible they recognise and which they don't.
This way, a kind of consensus was evolving about what was scripture. Matthew, Mark, Luke and John, of course, the letters of Paul and so on. But behind the scenes, various bishops were also working hard to suppress or discredit anything they saw as heresy, dangerous views from the margins. Then, in the early 4th century AD, a technological development helped settle the New Testament canon or list of books.
In this period, you've got a transition from papyrus to parchment, to letters, animal skins. They're much more able to produce big books. So that plays a very important part in gathering together things into a single volume, which almost is a big statement of this is the Christian scripture. Here is, contained within this covers all that we need to know.
In 312 AD, the Roman Emperor Constantine converted, and suddenly Christianity was the faith of the most powerful man on earth. He commissioned 50 Bibles, putting pressure on decision makers to confirm what was in or out. Within a generation or so, the canon, the list of the books in the Bible, was as good as locked, just as it is today. Here's a copy of one of those very first Bibles, the Codex Vaticanus.
This is our oldest complete manuscript of the Greek Bible. It's a pinnacle, it's the mountaintop, it's in the 4th century. This is the canon, this is the Christian Bible, Greek Old Testament, Greek New Testament, laid out for reading, presumably in churches, as God's word for those churches.
So it not only contains scripture, but it's also a precious book within itself.
You know, it has a real presence for when you read it and study it. It's fantastic.
Is it priceless?
The original is, yes. This is obviously a copy, but the original is
is priceless. It couldn't be estimated. Last year, a single page of John's Gospel from a 3rd century manuscript sold for $400,000.
But however valuable, I'm still bothered by the idea that the Codex Vaticanus and the Bible today might not be the full story, that something wonderful may have been lost in what was essentially censorship.
Whenever you're compiling a book, there's always a big discussion about what should be excluded and what should be included. And there's always a row about it. I know because I've been on editorial boards and I've experienced that. So I'm really suspicious about all compilations, including the Bible. Although it was signed, sealed and delivered 1,600 years ago, I still think it's worth learning about what was excluded as well as what was included. I want to know what didn't make it into the Bible.
The dozens of Gospels and would-be scriptures that were kept out of the Bible remain suppressed, some literally buried for the next 1,500 years or more. As time passed, they've become shrouded in mystery, rumour and scandal. Had they been part of some dark counterculture? Or were they saying something about Jesus that people in power simply didn't want to hear? In Boston in the United States, a leading academic spent the last decade working on one such hidden gospel, a papyrus which turned up for sale in Egypt in 1896.
The person who was selling it was told that it had been discovered by a peasant in the niche of a wall near the area of Akhmim, which is sort of in Middle Egypt. But that absolutely can't be true, because no document could survive out in the open air for 1,500 years. So what we think probably is that it was a grave robbing, something not quite legal. Yeah. And then it appears on the antiquities market in Cairo. It was purchased by a German scholar and taken to Berlin.
The manuscript itself turned out to be a 5th century AD copy of an earlier 2nd century account of Jesus' life. And the key to why this gospel wasn't included in the Bible lies in the fact that it was written not in the name of Peter, Thomas or John, but Mary Magdalene, who I'd always been taught was a reformed prostitute.
She was an important follower of Jesus. She was a Jewish woman who came from the town of Magdala. That's where we get the name Magdalene, near the Sea of Galilee. She was the first witness to the resurrection and the first apostle, the first one sent out to give the message of the resurrection to the other apostles.
The Gospel of Mary, written by her 2nd century followers, enraged early church leaders. It contained, they said, heresy, shocking views out of line with theirs. But what angered them most was the fact it said women like Mary Magdalene were as fit to hold power within the church as men.
The canon itself was made to exclude. There's a tendency to push women to the background. But all the evidence again and again shows us that women were apostles. But the collection of literature that ended up in Orthodoxy and in the New Testament is very selective, and it tended to select that literature that conformed to ideas that excluded women from positions of leadership.
And it wasn't just enough for church authorities to keep Mary Magdalene's gospel out of the Bible. They then undermined her reputation with that old trick, the sexual smear campaign.
There's not a shred of evidence in the New Testament Gospels or any early literature that Mary Magdalene was a prostitute. And yet that is the dominant image that's come down to us today. But if you read the text, it's not there.
They got away with it simply because there's too many Marys in the New Testament and it's just plain confusing. One of them, not Mary Magdalene, anoints Jesus in the Gospel of John. Then in Luke, a so-called sinner woman also anoints Jesus. So the confusion was cooked up around the 5th century AD, and for the next 1,500 years, Mary Magdalene was that sinner woman.
History is always told by the winners, and the New Testament is certainly that compilation of books that won out in the battle for orthodoxy.
It seems to me that you're saying the Gospel of Mary never made it because of politics.
Politics are always involved. Power relations are involved. Who gets to say this is the way you should live, this is the way you should think, this is the way it should be. These questions of orthodoxy and heresy, what made it into the New Testament canon, these had very definite implications for who was in charge.
Shocked by finding such chauvinism at the heart of the Bible, I think you have to put some of this stuff to the people in charge of the established church. Next stop, an appointment with the head of the Pope's Bible Institute at the Vatican. Today, people swear on the Bible in court. Some people will hold it, will put it in a place of prominence in their homes. Why do you think people revere the book itself?
Well, I think there's something that people consider sacred about the written page, that this has in itself a kind of authority. And so the written word of God, materially written word of God, has a kind of power or sacredness in itself.
But what had given men the right to decide whether it really was the word of God or not?
One of the major motivations came from heretics. Someone who believes something that's different from what would be considered the standard of faith or the standard of belief.
Talking about a heretic is like talking about a freedom fighter, because a freedom fighter might be somebody we like, but to somebody else, it's a terrorist. Isn't that also true for a heretic? Wasn't the church then making a judgment as to which text they saw as being legit and which were illegitimate?
Oh, certainly, because certain people who accepted certain books that not everyone else accepted had to be told that these were not part of the official list.
Are there any books that were written by women included in the canon?
As far as I know, no.
You've got councils, you've got men meeting, the learned, the powerful, the influential, the scholarly, to determine what should be in the canon. Isn't that really the work of men rather than the work of God?
Well, at the particular time, there was men who were used as God's instruments in producing these things. The Holy Spirit has a role in order to make sure that there is proper doctrine in the church.
So are you saying that the Spirit was present countering bias, ignorance, or even prejudice in the formation of the canon?
Well, I think when you have a human group, there is bias, ignorance, and prejudice present. I mean, that's just the human reality. Hopefully, when you have this large group of people working together, that the final outcome is the outcome that was desired by the Spirit.
That sounds like potluck. Surely there must be something more dramatic and powerful the Spirit is doing to modify this group of powerful men.
The Spirit works very quietly.
But one passage from the very end of the book of Revelation keeps running through my mind. They're the very last words of the whole Bible, and they read as an open threat to anyone thinking about messing with the book as it's been laid out.
If any man shall add unto these things, God shall add unto him the plagues that are written in this book. And if any man shall take away from the words of the book, God shall take away his part out of the book of life.
At this point, it seems to me that canon formation is all about a group of rich and powerful people putting a text together and deciding who they want to include in orthodoxy and who they want to exclude. Now, where's the Spirit in this? You know what I think? The Spirit is at work today. The Spirit gives you the ability to see the ignorance, the bias, and the prejudice that was involved and raise questions about the legitimacy and accuracy of what took place. That's the work of the Spirit for me, the power to read through what was going on.
But the politics by no means finishes in 4th century Rome. And to get to my Bible in English as it is today, there'd be new authors, editorial feuds, and even bloodshed. Bethlehem, according to Matthew's Gospel, the birthplace of Jesus Christ.
But there's another reason why this is a key stop on my trail in search of who wrote the Bible. In the 4th century AD, the list of books in the Bible was more or less fixed, but rewriting what was in them continued. In the 380s, a man called Jerome came here to Bethlehem on orders from the Pope. He took a crash course in Hebrew and soon settled down to work in a cave below this church. His aim? To bring the Bible to a new audience down in the dirt of his home streets back in Rome. Jerome is really important because he translates the Bible into a popular Western language, Latin. That means it's more accessible and can be read by many more people. He did what the printing press would do later and what the internet does today, revolutionizes access to the Bible. Jerome's translation was deeply flawed, but it dominated for centuries to come. Pretty much anyone who read the Bible anywhere in the West read Jerome's version of things. But the story of who wrote perhaps the most famous and widely read Bible ever begins 1,000 years later, and for me, much closer to home in Oxford. By the late 1300s, the books that make up the Bible had been together for 1,000 years, but they weren't translated into English. Now that meant that the only people who could read the Bible were experts in Latin, and there weren't many of those. But things were about to change. A group of scholars decided that they were going to translate the Bible into English. But that was a dangerous thing to do back then. It was an act of subversion, and you were risking your life. In the 1370s, a scholar called John Wycliffe was causing ripples amongst the church establishment. He was full of militant ideas, not least that the clergy shouldn't be allowed to own their own property. But the real hot potato was Wycliffe's big idea about the Bible.
Wycliffe had a very strong sense that both English society and the English church really needed to be reformed, and above all, to be liberated from the influence of the church based in Rome. And Wycliffe saw that to empower the English people to change things, they needed to have access to the Bible in their own language, a language that they could understand.
And this wasn't just about religion. It was about who was controlling who in medieval society.
In the Middle Ages, you cannot separate politics and religion, and Wycliffe was very actively religious and also very active politically. Wycliffe believed that government should be of the people, by the people, for the people, and saw that as grounded in the New Testament. So why shouldn't ordinary people have access to the New Testament and see that idea for themselves?
The problem was that this was downright taboo. The last thing the church wanted to do was give ordinary people the power to come up with their own interpretation of what the Bible said. But Wycliffe urged defiance. Though he never actually translated much himself, he rallied others to pick their way through Jerome's Latin Bible and come up with the first English Bible ever.
Well, this isn't one of Wycliffe's personal Bibles. It's a Wycliffeite Bible. In other words, a Bible produced by Wycliffe and his circle.
Now, how subversive was it to have one of these in your personal possession?
It was illegal to produce a Bible in English. It was illegal to possess a Bible in English.
So having a copy of this by the fireplace in your mansion, the police come in, you're in trouble.
You wouldn't be showing this to any other than your friends.
Pope Martin was so disgusted by what Wycliffe stood for that 44 years after his death, he ordered that his bones be dug up and publicly burned. But another English Bible translator would suffer even worse. His ideas too were formed as a clergyman scholar here in Oxford, and they're a milestone on the road to Protestant England. His name was William Tyndale.
There's no doubt that Tyndale was inspired by Wycliffe's example. But Tyndale was quite convinced that Wycliffe's translations were not good enough. And it wasn't that he based himself on Wycliffe and tried to improve. In many ways, he was starting all over again.
Unlike Wycliffe, Tyndale had access to the Greek text of the New Testament and the Hebrew text of the Old Testament. So rather than work from the flawed Latin of Jerome's Bible, Tyndale could sit down with the originals and put his creative talent to work.
This is a copy of Tyndale's New Testament, the first ever New Testament to be produced directly from the Greek and printed in English. This was mass-produced, much cheaper in comparison with the Wycliffeite version. Tyndale's scholarship in translating the Bible is universally regarded as amazingly good, not simply in terms of the technicalities of translation, but also in terms of the way he actually uses English. Phrases like the salt of the earth, that phrase goes right back to Tyndale.
By the mid-1520s, the ban on an English Bible was so hard-line that Tyndale fled to the continent. But there was no escape. In October 1536, the Catholic authorities captured him. He was strangled and burned at the stake.
But Tyndale's words lingered on. I would argue that whatever English version you're using today, the ghost of Tyndale haunts its pages.
Even before Tyndale's death, it had finally become okay to have an English Bible back in England. The country was now Protestant, but the elite were concerned about continued religious infighting and decided it would be much better if it were their Bible. So in 1604, King James commissioned another translation, lifting up to 85% from Tyndale and then adding the royal seal of approval.
King James assembled probably as many as 54 translators, including the best scholars in the land, to create this new translation.
What was in this for the king?
The need to generate a religious consensus. James did not want his kingdom to be broken apart by religious controversy. He wanted this new Bible to bring religious peace and harmony.
So the King James Version was deeply political.
There's no doubt James had a religious motivation, but really the political agenda was such he made sure that there were representatives of the rival factions on those translation committees. The idea was we could reunite England under the Bible.
The King James Version remained the only acceptable English Bible from 1611 until the First World War. It's still a worldwide bestseller, and the translation revolution lives on. There are now countless modern versions of what Wycliffe and Tyndale were doing, written for the audience of the moment. A Scots Bible, a hip-hop Bible, even a Bible for teenage girls.
If you think of the remix in modern music, where you have an original version that then gets reworked by 20 different people, well, with the Bible, you get thousands of reworkings taking place of the original text. So modern translators stand in a long line of people re-editing, reworking the Bible. There's layer upon layer of meaning. So when it comes to biblical translation, there's nothing new under the sun.
My journey's almost over. It's taken me back thousands of years, but the questions I've been asking matter today more than ever, and I'll tell you why.
Freedom and fear are at war.
US President George W. Bush claims to live by the Bible, and between 30 and 40% of the American electorate are evangelical Christians who believe that God wrote it. Just before the presidential elections, Bush knows if he rallies the religious hardliners that didn't vote last time, it'll be four more years in the White House.
If the Christians in America get right with God, God will bless America. If they don't, God's not going to bless America.
I'm on my way to a Baptist church in Georgia to meet a big-time preacher who's been dubbed spiritual advisor to the president. He's known Bush since 1988 and even wears presidential cufflinks.
What does the Bible mean to George Bush?
I believe he believes it's God's word and it's a source of guidance.
God said it. That settles it. I believe it.
The most important source of knowledge about good and evil, right and wrong, meaning and purpose for human life that is available to human beings.
I was asked the other day by a liberal if I had anything I would suggest the president have done differently. I said, yes. I would have flooded Iraq with American troops. Not 120,000, 500,000.
Is it right for the Bible to impact domestic and foreign policy?
Sure.
biblical truth is truth with a capital T. And if it's true on Sunday, it's true on Monday. It's true 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, and it should apply to every area of our lives.
For a Christian to be involved in an armed conflict means that it must be authorized by the legitimate authority. I do not believe that a legitimate authority for the United States is the United Nations. Now, if they want to agree with us, great. But if they don't, I don't care.
Does reading the Bible make you a better president?
Well, as a Christian, I believe it does. I don't think it'd make you a better person, a better husband, a better senator, a better wife, a better father, a better mother, a better welder, a better lawyer. It'll make you a better human being.
On this journey, I've been looking at who wrote the Bible, and I've come across theologians who say you don't have to take the New Testament literally because it was written decades after those events took place. So surely one needs to be a little bit more flexible.
I think surely not. It's not a question of intellect. It's not a question of scholarship. It's a question of faith. Most of the people that you're referring to come to the Bible with what I call a Napoleonic code assumption. And in the Napoleonic code, you're guilty until proven innocent. And I come to it with an English common law approach. You're innocent until proven guilty. It's God's word until you prove it isn't.
There are theologians who argue that the biblical text was written thousands of years ago, is inaccurate, and can't be the basis of sound domestic or international policy. What do you say to that?
Rubbish. You wanted a short answer, I'll give you a short answer. Rubbish. Dangerous rubbish. When you believe the Bible and you follow the Bible, God blesses you and you grow. When you stand in judgment of Scripture, that is a theology of death.
I want to thank you all for your hard work.
16 days later, the American electorate gave George W. Bush a landslide victory. Many believe that preachers like Richard Land and Bush's own very public relationship with the Bible won the day. It's been an earth-shattering journey for me, from my roots where whatever you do, you certainly never question the Bible. First, the so-called law of Moses turns out to be the work of many human hands. Then I find much of the Old Testament was ruled by ancient politics as much as by divine insight. The New Testament, too, turns out to be a masterwork of spin, written by people who are nowhere near the events they describe, all gathered together by powerful editors who made sure to keep out ideas they didn't like.
But my mother always taught me, stay intelligent despite your education. And what she meant by that was use your experience to work out what's in front of you. And if I apply that to this journey, who wrote the Bible? Well, I've learned that biblical authorship is messy, and it's messy because life is imperfect. And if we can find God in the imperfections of our lives, of my life, then maybe we can find God in the messiness of the text. Who wrote the Bible? Well, it's a complex question, and it takes some thinking through. And that tells me that to have faith in the world today is to ask questions and never have the wool pulled over your eyes.
You can find out more about Robert Beckford's research on the history of the Bible at channel4.com/believe. Next on 4, how ready is Britain to deal with a terrorist attack on home soil? Don't panic.